the Nomiki Show.
Hello, TNS Book Club members and viewers. Book Club is going well. The book, Repair, Redeeming the Promise of Abolition. The author is Katherine Franke, who's here to join us today. She is also the author of Wedlocked, The Perils of Marriage Equality, which came out in 2017. And she is, let me get this right. She is from at the Doore Center, right? At Columbia? Is that correct?
No.
You can correct me. It's okay. We're okay. Casual.
I'm the Doore Professor of Law.
Professor of Law. Got it. Doore Professor of Law. All these titles are amazing.
They are.
I never get them right.
I'd rather you get the book right than my title right.
Most important thing, because this is what people are reading right now. It's a fascinating book talking about really what happened during the reparations period, which was supposed to happen, but, you know, Reformation and whether or not reparations, the promise of reparations, which we, I think, are all very aware, was enacted and what that means for today. So thank you for joining us, Katherine.
Oh, it's my great pleasure. Thank you for inviting me.
So, I mean, let's just start with what inspired you to write this book and why now?
Well, when I was doing research on my first book, which was looking at what African-American people went through at the end of the Civil War when they could marry for the first time, and whether there were any lessons for same-sex couples today about what it means to be freer through the institution of marriage, I came across all this really interesting data and, you know, real material resources in archives in Mississippi, in North Carolina, in South Carolina, in Georgia, where there were real experiments, real projects in reparations delivered to free people, newly free people in those states, that most people didn't know about. So I thought, all right, that's my second book. I'm going to write about that, because we don't get taught this in middle school American history, that we actually gave reparations in the form of land to Black people at the end of the Civil War, and then it was all taken back. And I can lay all that story out for you, but that's the story of the book, of how, you know, this call today for reparations is not a radical idea. It's not one that just came up recently. It was actually a normal idea in the 1860s.
I mean, that was what was so revealing to me, was how you had communities in which white power brokers, whether they were generals or elected, were advocating for the freedman, mm-hmm. as you label in the book, as you say in the book, to be able to have, you know, to take property from the previous landowners. Many of them were northern, et cetera, and really become self-sufficient on the land, not just own the land, enough land, fertile land, but be able to farm on the land, even cotton, which was very controversial, but to be able to be able to build their own wealth. And that was like a real conversation. And of course it went the other way when you know, Abraham Lincoln was killed. So I want to start with just South Carolina, the Sea Islands.
Yeah.
This is, how did you discover what was happening in the Sea Islands?
Well, the Northern military during the Civil War invaded the Sea Islands area. They came down the East Coast. They occupied with battleships the Port Royal area. And if you've been to this area, it's where Hilton Head and places like that are located. It's just a breathtakingly beautiful place, right? So the Northern military show up. They occupy this area of South Carolina. The white enslavers, the white plantation owners, flee to the mainland and leave the Black people there on the Sea Islands. And the Black people are like, okay, let's see what happens next with this other group of white people who they didn't know. So the white military shows up, occupies this area, and declares by mere fact of their presence there that everyone that had been enslaved was freed. So from one day to the next, and this is way before the Emancipation Proclamation, that's 1863. We're talking 1861 here. The mere presence of Northern troops occupying that land rendered 15, 20,000 Black people freed. And so the Black people of the Sea Islands, who were living in community, in kind of complicated kinship groups, because that's how they were housed and lived according to the rules of slavery, they approached the military officials, the white military officials, and they said, we know what we want. We want land, we want this land, and we want you to go away. That's It's what we expect freedom to look like. You know, finish your war. We know we have a stake in that war. But, you know, it's island culture. What was going on in the Sea Islands was in so many ways divorced from what was going on in the mainland. And of course, Black people could not read or write. It was a crime to teach Black people to read or write, so they weren't reading newspapers. And they actually spoke their own language, the Gullah language. So they had a very kind of insular culture and a very strong sense of community. And they sat down with the military leaders who were in charge of the military campaign there. And they said, ultimately, what we want is the land and for us to own it outright and for you all to leave us alone because we need to heal in community with ourselves. We don't really need to be in community with you. And amazingly, the white military officials and the politicians in Washington listened to them and did it. So what they did pretty shortly after the invasion of the Sea Islands is Congress passed a law that assessed a property tax on Confederate landowners. And if you didn't pay the tax, the federal government, the Northern government, could seize your land. Now, of course, no Confederate landowner was going to pay taxes to the government in Washington. They'd seceded from the government in Washington, right? They were at war with them. So the U.S. government seized all of this land in the Sea Islands and then started breaking it up into large, not just 40 acres, but even larger plots, and said to the people of the Sea Islands, you tell us which plots you want, and we will give you title to that land, and it will be yours. For you and your community to heal. And so I was in these archives looking at these records where Black people were in groups signing their names with an X. You know, they couldn't sign their own names because they didn't know how to write. But I have to say it was so moving opening up these little creaky pieces of paper that in many cases had not been opened since the 1860s. And seeing an unsteady hand make an X on a deed, a title to land. And sometimes you could see they were so kind of moved by the moment that the ink might have spilled on their palms or their fingertips. And so there were other, you know, pieces of evidence of not only freedom, because these were definitely their first acts of being free, but their first acts as humans, right? They had gone from being property to being human beings and then being able to own property. I can only imagine what that must have been like for the freed people of the Sea Islands. So they began to plant crops. And you mentioned cotton earlier. They didn't want to plant cotton.
They Why knew was that? That?
Well, because you can't eat cotton. The cotton was sold out of the area. Actually, most of it was sold to Europe because in the Sea Islands, they're able to grow this very high-end form of cotton. And so it left the United States entirely. It was extremely profitable. And the freed people knew that while enslaved, working cotton was just, you know, horrible work. And they were never paid for it, of course, because they were enslaved and they couldn't eat it. So what they wanted were crops that they could eat and that would sustain their culture. So they really resisted growing cotton again. And instead were planting corn and potatoes and wheat and things like that in order to build new lives there and started to build homes and et cetera. And so there was this sort of sense of hope that freedom might look like something very different from what it ended up being, because as soon as Lincoln was assassinated, Andrew Johnson becomes president. One of the first things he does is grant amnesty to the former Confederates and restore all of their property except in enslaved people. All of that land was violently taken from the freed people who had title to it and returned to their white slave owners. And then they were forced to enter into year-long labor contracts with the people who had previously enslaved them.
So essentially, it was—
Just take a breath. I mean, that is a really horrible story.
To become they go from taking over, in many cases, taking over the land that they've been working on for generations, mm-hmm. and signing, you know, these deeds, rightfully so, and then many of their previous slaveholders now have to go into labor to bring them back into being labor for, you know, very little pay, of course. It's not
very little pay, and often they didn't even pay them. So this is what freedom looked like,
right.
An awful lot like what it meant to be enslaved.
Can we rewind just a little bit? Because there was this process before that, if I understand correctly, the bidding process,
yes.
In which, you know, on one hand, there was an opportunity for the previously enslaved people to bid on land, but it was also open to, say, Northerners.
Yes.
And that doesn't sound like it sounds like a no-compete contract.
Exactly. Right. So, you know, to complicate the story, there were two tracks of what they were going to do with the land once it had been seized. A lot of it was set aside to give to the freed people explicitly as reparations. They were using that term. And then other parts of the land, the government decided, well, why don't we auction that? We need the money to pay for the war. So let's auction it, and we will auction off some of it at a lower price so that Black people can bid on it. And they, you know, they've been selling crops and making a little bit of money and squirreling away a little money at that point. So they were able to bid. And then some of it was just an open market bidding on the land. And part of what I recount in the book is the heartbreaking process where people who for 3-4 generations had lived on land crimped and saved in order to collectively bid to keep that land. And then some investor from Boston outbids them by $1 or $5. And they're just heartbroken. Like, who is this person, right? That happened over and over and over again. And it was just devastating at these auctions. And so these Northern investors that were described as vultures, really, vulture capitalists, an early version of them, came down and bought up a lot of this land. And so this, you know, the story of the area is a bad one from the perspective of Southern white people who were slave owners, but not a very good story from the perspective of Northern white people either, because these were Guggenheims and very wealthy industrialists from the North who were financing the purchase of this land as a longer term investment with the thought that they would have a very cheap, if not free, labor source there to farm the land with them living still in their mansions in Boston or New York or Philadelphia.
The Irving family. I mean, these are all, if you walk down the streets of New York, their names are everywhere.
Yep, exactly. And so to the extent that some of, you know, I didn't grow up in the South. My family actually didn't even come to the United States until well after the Civil War was over. So, you know, I don't have any responsibility for this, these sets of issues. Actually, wealth across the country, white wealth across the country was implicated in what happened in the South, particularly in this period. It's not just a Southern story, it's a national story. And all of us need to know it and take account of it.
Let's talk a little bit about Johnson, because man, what a guy.
Yeah.
I mean, we all probably know that already, but what a turn of events. It seems like previously enslaved people have a real shot at reparations or version of reparations, even with these bidding contracts. There were still discussions. There were still, you know, white power brokers and generals who were fighting against the bid process. There were advocates, allies. And it seems like when Johnson came in, allies kicked out.
Well, Johnson was an enslaver himself. He was a slavery supporter. Lincoln put him on the ticket the second time he ran for president because he was worried of losing. And, you know, the war wasn't going all that well. And so he figured if he had a Southerner who was a slavery sympathizer, it would help. And, you know, it did, but it also meant that when Lincoln was assassinated, you had basically a pro-slavery guy in the White House who didn't have any of the same political objectives or really even the same kind of morality that Abraham Lincoln did around the humanity of Black people. And so he very much saw them as a, you know, kind of a savage class that needed to be sort of disciplined in an agrarian farming kind of context where they enjoyed very few rights. And it was, you know, we always wonder what would have happened if Lincoln had not been assassinated. He wasn't perfect, to be sure, but it would have been quite different than what we saw.
So let's talk about some of the legislation, the Homestead Act, of course. I think many of us are aware of that, but could you remind folks what the Homestead Act really...
Thank you for raising it, because at the very time that some Northern politicians and all freed Black people were saying, we need land to be free people, but also as reparations for enslavement. And then the federal government is saying, absolutely not. We're going to make you work for the people that enslaved you before. The federal government also passed the Homestead Act that took millions and millions of acres of land in the West and gave it away for free to white people. All white people got land for free. If you live, if you claimed it, you know, filed a claim to it in a land office, worked it for a few years, paid an $8 fee at the end, it was yours. And recently a study was done that showed that around a third of the white people in the United States can trace their family wealth to the Homestead Act. So while we were stealing land from Black people, never mind what we were doing with Native American people, which is also an interesting story I'm happy to talk about, but during this exact same years that we had the possibility of a very small amount of land being given to Black people as reparations, then taken away, we were giving away millions of acres in the West to white people who were then accumulating wealth, accumulating a whole, you know, culture and life that has in through the generations resulted in what we now know is the racial wealth gap, that there is so much wealth in white families, largely as a result of holding real estate, Homestead Act real estate or otherwise, that Black people could never have gotten in on that deal. Right? And so part of why wealth has never accumulated in Black families and in Black communities is that they never had the initial resources to make an investment, sit on it, let it increase in value, sell it, make another investment, you know, the American way of gaining wealth. So these two things are happening at the exact same time where white people are being given land and Black people are having land that had been given to them as reparations being stolen from them.
Well, what's so crazy to me, when I had to go back and read this again, when Johnson basically offered former slaveholders their land again, there was also financial attachment to that. Like they were, this is mind-boggling. They received reparations.
They did. So not every one of the slave owners who had left the Sea Islands returned. Some of them had settled elsewhere and they were like, we're not going back there. And actually a presidential governmental commission was created to track down those people, assess the value of the land that had been taken under these tax seizures, and pay them for that land plus interest. So they got reparations. Now, these are people who had rebelled against the United States, right? They had left the United States. You think there might be some cost for that, but no, there wasn't. In fact, they got paid and they got paid well for the value of the land that had been taken in these tax seizures.
And the military went to protect the land against the formerly enslaved people who were living on the land, and they started to squat. They were advised to squat by. Mm-hmm. And this is it just seems so similar today to say the police department always finding a way to protect their own and reward their own, even if they murder people. And of course, you know, Black Americans across the country being murdered by the police. Similar dynamics. So let's talk a little bit about what reparations means today. I know that there are bills right now. I think just a couple of days ago in Illinois, there was a reparations bill that was presented and passed in Evanston, I believe. And then Pennsylvania, there is one of our friends of our show, Representative Chris Rapp, has introduced a reparations bill in Pennsylvania. So it's catching steam, but from what I've learned is that there are many different interpretations or types of bills, and the process is really important. But what are you suggesting, or what have you uncovered in terms of reparations?
Let me tell you a couple of things. One is what I recommend in the book, and then the other is the larger set of projects that you've just described that are going on that are not incompatible with what I've recognized. But what we're going through right now is the largest intergenerational wealth transfer we've ever seen on the planet. Right? My parents' generation are passing away, and they're passing down this accumulated wealth to people that are around my age, at a time when the estate tax is the lowest it's ever been, right? So most of that money is going to stay in white families and not be captured through taxes, even at like a moderate tax, right? And so what I recommend in the book is that we increase the estate tax, not to 100%, but to something higher than what it is now, put a lot of that money into a trust fund for reparations, and then create a commission that will make decisions about that, because there are people in the Black community who've been working on this for a very long time and have thought a lot of it through. But one of the things I think is an important component of a reparations project is investment in community land trusts. And there are a number of them across the country where the community owns the land. And then people in the community can live in the housing, can work in those spaces, they build schools. Jackson, Mississippi is a wonderful example of where there's a huge abandoned part of the city. Detroit's another. And what the Black community has done is bought from the city this basically abandoned land for a dollar. And then as a community decided what they want to do with it, they're building housing, they're building urban farms, they're building the capacity to be energy independent. So they're not dependent on these large, you know, you think of what happened in Texas in the last storm, where we privatized to for-profit companies the provision of an essential utility that had a disparate impact, particularly on peoples of color and poor people. And so in these programs empower the community and enrich the community, not just enrich individuals, which is what a check being written by the government to individuals would do. And we may want to do that also. But I prefer, or I like making sure that we also have community empowerment projects as part of what we're doing as well. Now, you mentioned Evanston. I was born in Evanston, Illinois, at Evanston Hospital. And I've been working with Robin Ruth Simmons, the alderman, who is responsible for this really amazing reparations project that they're doing in Evanston, where marijuana sales have been recently legalized. They're taking the taxes that the city would be getting from marijuana sales and using a good chunk of them for reparations, for race discrimination, to repair race discrimination in Evanston. And they're asking people to come forward who have experienced racism in housing in Evanston during a period of time, and they'll get a $25,000 grant towards the purchase of a home, either a down payment on your mortgage, et cetera. And, you know, some people are saying that's not enough. Actually, the real estate in Evanston is a lot more expensive than that. So there's some pushback, but it's a really innovative idea to address that history of discrimination in Evanston. And boy, do I remember it when I was a kid living there. It was a very segregated, you know, like most cities were, but Chicago and the Chicago area certainly had large Black populations, but very, very segregated populations. So they're experimenting with that. But really, where the new innovation, you know, even before these towns and the federal government or other states are addressing it, it's been private institutions, churches, Georgetown University, a bunch of universities, seminaries have recognized their history and their relationship to the institution of slavery, to the point like Georgetown was at a point where it was going to go out of business. And so they sold a bunch of people, slaves that the Jesuit church owned.
Oh my goodness.
In order to pay their bills. And they've now come to terms with that. And they've found out who the descendants of those enslaved people were, who they sold. And they were given, you know, lifetime free admission to Georgetown, plus other forms of reparations. And so I think each institution will have a different approach, given what the history of slavery and or racism looked like in those institutions. And I think that kind of innovating is a good idea, because slavery has been a different thing, as has, you know, this racism that persisted after the end of slavery. It's been a different thing in different places. So I think thinking in creative ways is really what's called for.
Do you see this happening mostly at the local level before it gets to the federal level?
Well, there's a bill in Congress, H.R. 40, that right. This year for the first time actually got a real hearing and is moving. And but it doesn't call for reparations. It calls for a commission to look at what reparations would look like. And so the fact that someone might oppose it, because it's not, it is actually quite telling itself. But with a Democratic Congress, finally, you know, barely, the reparations bill may actually make its way through Congress. The filibuster will be a problem. But
I was just going to say, Robert Byrd's filibuster, Joe Manson loves to say, inherited the position from him. You know, that's also telling.
Yeah. And there, you know, the Biden administration has a lot of important priorities. So we'll see what they're willing to spend political capital on. But the reparations bill is certainly an important one.
Katherine Franke, this was such an interesting book, such a fast conversation. I have so many more questions to ask. So maybe we can set up a Zoom call with our readers at some point, in the coming months.
I'd love that.
Wonderful book. Very smooth read too, by the way. Really, I read it so quickly.
Let me tell you, the book's coming out in paperback in June, and it will have a reader's guide in the back.
That's great.
With questions for reading groups and folks that want to kind of think hard about some of the issues that are raised back in history, but also today. So look for that paperback coming out soon.
Fantastic. We'll definitely get a piece of that and start going over the reader's guide as well. Thank you for your time. Thank you for your commitment to the cause. And we'll hope to see you again soon.
You bet. Great to see you. Thank you so much.